what's up guys, Mark here. And in this video, I'm gonna be sharing with you my full keynote presentation from Affiliate Summit West last year in 2023. This was a presentation that I did with Dave Hall, the founder of MotoArt and Plain Tags. And if you're not familiar with Dave, Dave is actually my oldest client. We've been working together for over 8 years now and helped grow this brand from doing 2 to 3K a month to do multiple six figures a month. So this was a really fun presentation that we broke down how we've grown the brand over the last 8 years into what it is now. Plain Tags makes these really cool collector luggage tags and keychains out of old aircraft. So they take the skin of 747s and all of these big commercial aircraft and old historic aircraft and make these fun tags out of it. So this was a really fun presentation, and I apologize. The first few minutes are all slides because there was a little bit of an issue with our filmer on site. And then it goes into a little back and forth between slides and full presentation. But I think you're gonna enjoy it. We go through essentially how we've grown this brand with mobile commerce through really multiple channels, being email, SMS, and app push with TapCart. So hope you guys enjoy. It's a really fun presentation and we're gonna get into it now. Thanks.
All right, woo! It is time for the final session of the day. Stand up, everyone up, on your feet, on your feet, on your feet. Everyone up, come on guys. You've never been to Affiliate Summit West like this before. Everyone up. All right, any everyone moving? Are we feeling good? Yes? Well, I need all the blood flowing because this next presentation is going to take you guys to the moon. Go ahead and have a seat. So it's time now for the final presentation for day one of Affiliate Summit West. Are you guys taking photos? Are you posting on social media? Hello, 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 hello. Are you posting on social media? Yeah? Okay, what's the hashtag? ASW23. Please make sure you guys are sharing your posts, et cetera. So final session of the day. For those of you who are new to the room, I'm Dominique Murphy. I'm the official host of this year's event. I'm a 3-time Emmy award-winning television personality and founder of The Right Method Creative Agency. So up next, we are gonna talk about the mobile commerce blueprint. How to expand past email and SMS with app push and mobile commerce. How many people are utilizing their mobile platforms to their advantage? Nobody. Well, then you guys are in for one person. Okay. Well, you guys are in for a treat. I'm excited for this one. I'm going to be in the back taking notes myself. We're going to have Dave Hall and Mark Milliton come to the stage right now. Go ahead and welcome them with me.
Hi.
Hey.
Hey, what's up everyone? How are you? My name is Mark Milliton and this is Dave Hall. And today we're gonna be talking about mobile commerce and how you can leverage it and how you can actually use it to make more money through selling stuff online. So, my goal of this presentation today is really to tell you like what we've been able to do with Dave's company, Plain Tags, over the last 8 years, but specifically over the last 2.5, 3 years, how we've leveraged building mobile apps and actually turning that into a commerce channel for scaling e-com. So we're gonna start off getting you a little more information about us. My name's Mark Milliton. I own an agency called Breadloaf and a coaching program called Brand Marketer. We work with D2C e-commerce brands that are doing $1 million to $40 million a year in helping them scale their retention revenue and drive paid acquisition. So around 80% of what we do is email, SMS, app push. We do the copywriting, design, strategy, planning, implementation, build out, and we're sending anywhere from 2 to 14 campaigns a week per client across all those channels. And specifically, brands in the Shopify ecosystem is what we specialize in. But now I'm going to head it over to Dave.
Hi. Hey, thank you for having me. So I have a very unique company, we started about 22 years ago. And what we do is we basically dismantle aircraft. We go to boneyards across the country, from Roswell to Mojave, and we literally tear down airplanes. What do we do with them? Well, we started 20 years ago by making conference tables, exhibits, working for all the major airlines. Anytime we saw something funky made out of an airplane, that was us. We were so funky that Discovery Channel came to us back in 2004, and we actually had a reality TV show, one of the first ever. They followed us around the country, all these different boneyards, and unfortunately, I lost my business partner at the time, and we had to really kind of start over. And what was incredible about Moto Art, you know, we would make these beautiful pieces, and I'd be the first to tell you, I could never afford my own stuff, right? I mean, the stuff, we'd have hundreds and hundreds of hours that would go into this wing or this engine cowling, and who really bought into it was corporate. So that was our market. You know, it was all the major aerospace companies and people who were buying our product. But we knew that there was a market there because everyone wanted to own a piece of aviation history. So at one point, I was working with an old P-51 Mustang. If you guys know your World War II aircraft, that's one of our old fighters. And I couldn't get rid of this damaged air scoop that they had. So I kept the skin. And I'm like, you know, one of these days, I'm going to do something really cool with this. Instead of like a dog tag, I'm going to make a plane tag. And I'm going to put the serial number of that aircraft on it, the schematic of that aircraft. And sat in my pocket for probably 6-7 years before I acted on it. And then one year, this is before I met Mark, I started a WordPress website, put up a couple tags on it. And it was almost like that. You ever seen a commercial like ding, 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 ding? Because we had a built-in market, because people had been following us for years, buying these little luggage tags made out of the aircraft. And we were documenting different planes, DC-9s, 747s, DC-3s. But I came to a standstill because I only had that certain audience. And that's where I met Mark. And Mark came in, and he really kind of opened us up to a much larger market. Immediately starting with Shopify, he recreated our website. And now since then, it's been, what, 6-7 years?
Eight years, yeah. And what's interesting about it, when Dave and I started working together 8 years ago, he had this built-in audience with Moto Art, right? I think it was probably like a 12 to 14,000 person email list.
Right.
And these were people that signed up for the newsletter through a pop-up or footer or sweepstakes or something over the years. And Dave had incredible press. You want to talk about the press you had over the years with that business?
Yeah, we because back in the day, we didn't have the web, right? I'm talking back in early 2000s. So who was really eating us up was the magazines, right? They're looking for eye candy. So we'd always, like, every time we'd come out with a new product, we'd send it out to all the editors. And before you know it, we're in Maxim magazine or Men's Journal or Architectural Digest. And that was really where we had our audience. We never really could afford to do what we're doing today until we had the product. And that's where we're, you know, so we stepped up with Mark, already having a name in the industry, but we didn't know how to market to the world like we were doing. Like, you know, we didn't have a TV show anymore. So that's where Mark came up to the plate and introduced the whole social media advertising. You know, a little bit more about the product. The product has gotten so big now that we're really trying to document aviation history. We're in the Smithsonian. We're at Pima Air and Space. We're in museums all over the world, and we're now getting derelicts coming to us that, you know, and I always say, no one learns more than I do, and that's what these museums are recognizing, is it's an educational tool. I mean, what kid knows what a P-51 Mustang is anymore? So we've had really good success on trying to document aviation history, and with Mark's help and the tools that he's given our company, it has grown substantially. Now I don't even want to make furniture, right? We still have that business. We still have, like, you know, a dozen people making furniture, which takes hundreds of hours. Now we're pressing out these tags, and what we're doing is we're going and cutting up these aircraft, and we're literally stamping them, laser etching the schematic and the serial number. It tells the whole story about that particular aircraft. And Mark has had a field day with this, because there's so much new content to constantly work with that the audience has just gotten bigger and bigger for us.
Yeah, so when we started working together, like I said, we had a built-in email list, but that was more of a B2B list. that had either signed up for the MotoR business over the years. So right away, we rebuilt the front end of the site in Shopify, got in the Shopify ecosystem so we could throw in the apps in there. And we doubled down on paid social with Facebook advertising. This product was a gem. It had perfect product market fit with paid social. From there, we layered into paid search, Google Shopping. You know, now we're running some programmatic. We're on TikTok. We run several paid channels still to, of course, still focus on customer acquisition. But what's really paid the dividends over the years has been email. Right, we started with that existing email list, and through all of the paid social efforts we've built over the years, we've been able to build in first-party data through email as a really, really strong pillar of a channel. And email with this product is incredible for us because of the LTV. Like, we're going to share a case study towards the end of just, or we're going to share something that actually happened the other day with one of our customers. But we've been able to build this email list to well over 100,000. And this email list, every time we launch a product, which we launch two products a month on average, sometimes three, it generates revenue, right? It pays itself. And the reason is this product is not someone does not buy this tag to be like, oh, I'm going to put it on my keychains. You totally can. And there are some people that do that. But most people collect these. I mean, we literally launched, we had the first Plain Tags Festival
right.
this last year. And
people flew from all over the world,
bought tickets to it.
They came to the festival.
Yeah. You want to talk about the festival a little?
Yeah. Well, you know, we saw the demand. We saw literally there's fan clubs now set up on Facebook that we don't control, that people are collecting these tags. And, you know, some people, I kid you not, have hundreds of plane tags. Not only do they buy that particular plane, but they buy every color variation of that aircraft that they had on it. And then there's a really big aftermarket, which is something that's amazing to see. We saw one of our plane tags, one plane tag, sell for $4,600 just about a month ago online, one of the earlier ones that we did. So there's this real craze, the collectability of what we're trying to do. And really what we're trying to do is we're trying to document aviation history, right? We're trying to go, I don't want to do a 747 over and over and over again. You know, we're really reaching in and trying to find different aircraft. Like our next release is an A-10 Warthog. I'm sure many of you guys have probably heard of the A-10. Well, we'll come out with that. And this A-10 was in camouflage color. So the collectors will try to buy every one of the colors that best represents that aircraft.
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy. When we go live with the product, I mean, we go live and people are literally pressing the refresh button on the website, like looking for that product to go live. And we'll talk a little bit about our product launch strategy in a minute. But going back to email was great for us, and it was a great channel, but we knew there was more that had to happen. We all know that email is, we're fighting for inbox space, we're fighting for open rates. Email can get very challenging. And with that being said, we then added SMS. So I believe we launched SMS in fall 2019. Mm-hmm. And interesting strategy with this. We had our largest product launch ever, which was going to be the SR-71 coming up at the beginning of December in 2019. So we knew this was going to be a really, really big push. We knew there was a lot of hype and anticipation. I mean, an SR-71 is literally, it's a piece of aviation history. There's like, the fact that you would be able to own a piece of that is yeah. insane. And we knew this would be the only time, right?
Yeah, definitely our most requested yeah. tag. And I hate to say it, I mean, it wasn't because of me, it was because of the SR-71. We had gotten this stabilizer from Skunk Works. The SR-71, it was actually donated to a museum in Louisiana. And, you know, Skunk Works called us and they're like, hey, can you make a conference table out of this? And all I'm thinking is plane tags, right? So we get this stabilizer, and we literally cut it up, and we made about 2,500 tags out of it. And, you know, Mark, you'll justify just how big this was. And what we did was we started doing some advertising online. It was a countdown, you know, 10 days, 9 days. And then when it hit, Mark, you were there on the front line.
Yeah, so this slide here gives you a little breakdown on like what we did with this. So this launch strategy, what we did is like I mentioned a minute ago, we've had several problems with like products selling out before people even had the chance to buy it. So we knew that SMS was going to be a good channel to actually pre-launch before we send an email, because everyone's going to get the SMS at the same time, theoretically, right? Carriers are going to send it out. The push is the SMS is going to go live. Bingo. So to launch SMS, what we did is we started pre-promoting it to our email list, essentially getting our email list and migrating them to SMS opt-ins. And we really used the carrot of the SR71 to be like, if you want early access, if you want access before anyone else gets access to this, then you're going to have to be on the SMS list. So we started with that. We also ran some warm retargeting ads. Here's an example of the ad we ran, which was literally like text plain tags to this short code to get opted into SMS. And through that, which we only did for like 2 weeks, we grew that SMS list from zero to 2,600, 2,700 people within a period of 2 weeks through running pre-promotion emails and also running a little warm retargeting to our warm audiences to get them to opt in, okay? That SMS list, I'm telling you, we set it live to 2,600 people. Within a period of less than 15 minutes, we did 70 grand in sales through that one SMS campaign to 2,600 people. I mean, I can't tell you, like, I've been running, you know, campaigns for 15 years now. I have never once, not even when I've ran campaigns with the Kardashians, have I seen these types of numbers. I mean, this was insane. And part of the reason is we had the right audience primed with the right offer and the right product, and we build up a lot of hype and anticipation around it. So the main takeaway I want you guys to see here is, like, you really don't need that many opt-ins to do a lot of money in revenue. Like, 15 minutes, 70 grand, doesn't matter if you're a 7, 8, 9 figure business, that's a lot of money in 15 minutes, especially for that size list. So we knew SMS was gonna be a big thing, and we started doubling down on it. We added it to our product launch strategy, where every time we launched, we were now sending an email and an SMS. As most of you know, if you're in e-commerce, like back in 2019, and not too many people were on SMS. That's right when Attentive start and PostScript started getting momentum. Attentive's the SMS platform that we're partners with, and we specifically use on plain tags, but a lot of brands were not using SMS back then. So there was this big open ocean to be able to send campaigns. And now, as you know, if you sign up for email and SMS campaigns during Black Friday this year, you were getting bombarded through your phone. If you're opting in, you're getting them left and right. So we knew that there had to be something else. And I think it was about a year and a half ago, we started partnering with Tapcart. And Tapcart is a no-code platform that actually lets you build and wrap Shopify sites into mobile iOS and Android apps. And the main reason I was interested in becoming a partner with Tapcart and really to start implementing these apps for our clients was the aspect of mobile push. If you run SMS, you know SMS can get quite expensive. We have some clients that have 10, 20, 50, 100, 200,000 SMS subscribers. You send one campaign, you've got to pay carrier fees per send, right? So it can get very expensive. The great thing about mobile push is you could have 100,000 subscribers and all you're paying is for the Tapcart platform, right? You can have as many iOS and Android subscribers as you want and it's not going to cost you any more. So what we did is we started dialing in our SMS send and essentially just lifted a little bit of the budget from SMS into Tapcart, and we built a mobile app. You guys can all go to the Apple or iOS store, download the Plain Tags app, search for it, it's right there. And what we've been doing now is turning that into our third pillar. So we have email, SMS, and now app push, right? We've got three first-party channels that we're collecting subscribers on, and when we go live and launch, we're hitting them on three platforms. We don't know if someone's going to open an email, right? They might have opted out of SMS, right? We don't know where people are. They might be in all three, right? The more touch points we can get, especially on the launch day or a promotion or a highlight, we know it's going to drive more revenue for us. So that's been our overall strategy, and it's been working really well for us. I mean, You know, we know email open rates and CTRs have been challenging, especially with the iOS 15 updates last fall in 2021. And we knew that these launches were just really great ways for us to drive the business. And honestly, Dave, if you want to talk about it a little, but from a financial perspective, when you can do tens of thousands of dollars of revenue on a launch day, it does a lot when you're running an e-commerce business.
Right. And first, I wish I had another SR71 wing. That was pretty amazing. But yeah, you know what's great is we're hitting it from like every angle. You know, we got the great email campaign. We have a great blog writer, and how helpful that has been as well, right? We got the SMS, we got the push cart, we got we're going to start a podcast here soon in the next coming weeks. And I think together, all these models of channels of bringing people to plane tags and introducing them to us trying to tell a story with these planes has been extremely successful. And we've seen the company grow you know, continuously every year. And so it's just been a really an amazing journey. I mean, just to kind of give you guys a sense of how many plane tags, we've probably sold over 500,000 of them and counting. I mean, we're just, it just gets bigger and bigger. So we're very fortunate. And like I said, you know, everyone's learning with what we're doing, and it's just a fun product to be representing.
So I mentioned a minute ago, like we have the launch framework that we use, and this is really frame down high level what our overall launch strategy looks like. Like I said, we're doing on average two launches a week. We like to do launches on Thursdays. They just seem to be the best day of the week for us to do a launch. So what we'll usually do a day or two before, usually on a Tuesday, we do a pre-launch email. And we'll usually be teasing this on social ahead of time as well. And we also have a closed, like, collector's Facebook group of, I think it's up to, like, 2,400, 2,800 people yeah. now.
The we'll real, like, it. True fans.
Yeah, yeah. These are,
the
like, literally.
Ones who set up that fan page I was talking about earlier.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. There's a group, and we didn't actually start it. It was a couple of the hyper fans that went out and started a closed collector's group. And there's chatter in this group every day. There's people trading tags, there's people selling tags, there's people talking about the history on this. I mean, we really tapped into this collector's community that didn't even exist before. So think about Pokemon cards, think about like anything collectors related. Collectors are super passionate, and we really tapped into this, and this has been part of the main reason for the success. So we do a pre-launch email that literally sets the tone for the launch, what's going to happen, when it's going to be going live. We usually do launches at 12 noon. It's just a good time where, you know, multiple time zones can still get into it. We have a huge international audience in China, Europe, and in New Zealand and in Australia. So we do the pre-launch email. Then on Thursday, we go live with email, SMS, and push directly. Those three channels, like I said, moving and getting all those channels together has really paid some massive dividends in that growth and the revenue that we're actually doing. And the cool thing too is like we might only have like 10, 30, or 40 tags of a specific color since, you know, Dave, you want to talk about it, like how...
Right.
How
well, I see you got Delta on the slide, and I wanted to say a word about Delta. Some of these airlines have been very supportive with what we're doing, including Delta, who we've partnered with. So 13% of every tag that we sell goes back to the Delta Care Fund. And what the Delta Care Fund is, it's a family fund in case, you know, one of their employees gets in trouble. So they're very supportive with what we're doing. And you can see we're standing there in front of it looks like an L1011. And you can see the blue, we're getting right out of the windows and then the logo. So the colors are really truly the colors that you see off the aircraft. I'm not sure if you guys have American Express, but we've also partnered with American Express now. There is now a 747 American Express card that we partner with. So it's just really coming out of the woodworks for us with all the different items that we can have to work with. But you were saying?
Yeah, yeah. So with that being said, we might only have so many SKUs, and the collectors know that if they want colored tags, they're going to have to work and act fast. I mean, it's like, it's, you know, anything, any product, when you can build the scarcity aspect around a launch, people take action. They put it in their calendar. They're actively focused on making that sale during a specific time. And that has really, like I said, been a great part of the growth of the overall brand, is we have this hype, anticipation, and FOMO and scarcity associated with it.
We'll sell out within seconds sometimes.
It's different color combinations
that we have.
There's actually some times where we have to limit like one or two like products per order. And we've built them some back-end like app infrastructure. And you're like some people would just buy every tag and then resell them on the secondary market. So we've had to build in some functionality during a few launches just to make sure that doesn't happen. Here's some examples of creative. You can see on the left right here, this is an example of what a mobile push looks like in the TapCart ecosystem. And by the way, if you guys are interested in building a TapCart app, you literally, it's a no-code platform. So it doesn't require any actual like software engineering. It's like building a front-end website. It does take some design, some functionality, some technical app integrations, but you know, it's something that anyone with a Shopify site could do. So if you're interested in learning a little bit more about it, like I'm happy to chat with you after the presentation. But that's exactly what the creative looks like. Mobile push comes up like the copy that we have, New Delta, fleet, plane tags, little copy down below. There's a character count, and then you can upload an image or use an image from the product you're launching. From this, this is a you know, launch that we just did this last Thursday, so really relevant. Then for SMS, you can see we're using Attentive for SMS, and then we use Klaviyo for email. So that's an example. We use pretty long form emails just because there's so much content that the team is doing research on. Plaintags literally has a historian on the team. They have a role. It's aviation historian to make sure that all the information on the product packaging and the website is actually accurate down to the down to every last level.
Right. What we found is airplane geeks are pretty smart. And they want to prove you wrong sometimes. And what's funny is, look, we're not perfect. We've made some mistakes in the past. We've launched over 150 different planes. And when they see a mistake, it's called out. And all of a sudden, those tags are worth 10 times the amount because now there's a mistake on the card. But we had to hire a historian because we couldn't put ourselves in that situation. So, you know, we really try to be 100% correct on everything that we do.
Yeah. And then closing it out a little on why push in mobile commerce. Well, I've talked about push in general. It's another first-party data point that you own. You know, as long as you're in the platform, like you have those push subscribers, and they're quite valuable to you over time. Also, like what we've seen is conversion rates. We've seen conversion rates go up to 7 to 10% in app versus 2.5, 2.8% on the regular website. So the more users you get opted in to push, you're gonna see higher conversion rates overall just because it's higher intent traffic, and you can actually give your subscribers and app users the ability to create a profile and save all of their credit card billing and shipping information directly in app. So we have people that have all their information saved in there. When a product goes live, they put it into cart, they get the push, they put it in the cart, they check out just like they're buying on Amazon, right? Streamlining it, not putting any roadblocks on that slip and slide down the purchase funnel. So it's, like I said, it's been super helpful, and we're really excited about it, and we're really doubling down on this. Right now, it's around 5 to 8% of the overall e-commerce revenue, but we're anticipating we'll be able to get this up to 10+% over this next year as we really focus more on getting users in and migrated over from these other channels. Another great thing too is you can actually run Facebook ads directly to in-app downloads. So let's say you wanted to be running a performance campaign and you wanted to get an idea on how much it's costing you to get an app download, you can install the Facebook SDK in the back end of the TapCart app and run ads and actually connect it to your ad account and get an idea on how much it's costing you to get an app downloaded at any given time. So, That is pretty much it for us. Yes. We've got a couple minutes left, and if you guys had any questions, I think we're going to put them up on the board.
All right, guys. Give it up for Mark and Dave. All right, guys, so go ahead and utilize the Slido app if you have any questions. So again, just scan the QR code here on either one of these monitors. Code is ASW23, and then click Main Stage. I'll kick it off with a question while we wait for everyone to enter their question. So what's next? You guys are on the cutting edge. We've talked about email marketing, SMS. What's the next big thing?
Well, I mentioned it. We are trying to put together a podcast because there's so much history in finding these relics. You know, it's not just given to us. You know, we were just in New Jersey last month, and we found a Lockheed Constellation that belonged to NASA. And this is so rare, and this guy had it in a junkyard. And we're like, stop, you know, don't move it around anymore. So we went and rescued it and worked on it, and we went and notified everyone that we found it. But there's so much great information that we just can't share on an email, right? So we decided, look, the only way, and I don't have a reality TV show anymore, so we figured the best way to do it is to start, you know, having a podcast and start getting, you know, behind the scenes of what we're really doing and some of the different stories. And, you know, and nothing's more of a bigger thrill than me than going to a new yard and finding something that that I don't know about. And like I said earlier, no one learns more than I do, which is amazing.
Yeah. So. And content syndication with the podcast. So really what we're doing is we know that people are coming to consume information on aviation. And, you know, we've had over 100 tags. How many? 150 plus?
Well over 150.
Yeah.
Different aircraft, not different tags.
So. All of these tags, all of these planes have a story. Like, some of these planes served in World War II, and then they got sold, and then they became a rescue plane up in Alaska, and then they got sold to somewhere else. So they have these incredible stories, and we do, you know, the content team does a great job writing blog content, but the thing is, as you guys know, everything's going with short-form video right now. We know that we have to double down on it, so our overall podcast strategy that we're literally in the process of launching over the next 2 weeks is when we launch a campaign on Tuesday, we're going to be launching a long-form 25 to 40 minute podcast episode, video podcast with Dave and the plain text historian. That's going to be a candid conversation, like Joe Rogan on the couch talking about the history of this plane and what it did. That's going to be syndicated to all the podcast networks, Google, Apple, Spotify, so forth. It's going to have its own subdomain of the site for good SEO, content marketing purposes. The long form is going to live on YouTube, and then we're going to chop up the long form into 4 to 6 shorts that are then going to get syndicated across all the platforms, TikTok, Facebook, YouTube Shorts, Insta Reels, and we're hoping that's going to be part of the syndication and organic social strategy over time.
Brilliant. Yeah. Repurposed content, the way to do it. Yeah. That's fantastic. Any other questions? Last chance. All right, guys, well, give it up for Mark and Dave. You can definitely connect with both of them in the Affiliate Summit West app, okay? So if you have a question and you're nervous or didn't get to it in time, you can connect with both of these gentlemen on the app.
All right,
thank you so much for being here.
Give
me a hug. Woohoo! All right, guys, and one last final announcement. This was our last session for the day, so go and be merry and have a lot of fun. We want to thank our sponsors here at Affiliate Summit West for everything that they did to make this event so successful. Also, we are back here tomorrow at 10:15. The Running Club kicks off at 7:30 in the morning. If you don't know what the Running Club is, check your app and you can find out the details for that group. And the Shopify Meetup takes place at 6:30 this evening at Top Golf, but you have to register. I'll say it again so no one gets mad. You have to register for the Top Golf event at the Shopify Meetup. Again, that's at 6:30 tonight. So make it a great day, guys, or not. The choice is yours. I'm Dominique Murphy, your official host of Affiliate Summit West, and I'll see you back here tomorrow at 10:15. Thanks, guys.